Well, anyway, it's an honor, you know, and it's so exciting to see a mix, you know, the high school students and the college students and band directors, junior high, senior high, and so forth. And, you know, we're all products of our environment. So throughout our lives, we're always seeking and absorbing experiences, knowledge, and skills. And you know, and I know, maturation is a lifetime process. I mean, Norville is still practices trumpet. It's 86 years old. And he's an example. Gary Gardner just is an amazing human being. I remember doing a clinic at his school, and he was sitting in the back taking notes. And he's the director of bands, and he knew the marching band. And I said, "What are you doing back there?" He said, "I'm taking notes." I said, "Why?" He says, "Well, you're never too old to stop learning." And that's kind of stuck with me. And so I thought I would start off telling a few jokes to loosen up a little bit, because I'm not a formal guy, but about as informal as you can get. Two of my favorite judging stories I want to tell you. The first one being in 1976, I was asked to come to UI, but I had been hired to judge the marching contest before, so I had to judge the marching contest. And that's back in the days when you used tick systems. You just walked around the field and put a tick mark down every time you saw a mistake. They were worth a tenth of a point. You had 20 points, so you had 200 tick marks you could put down. And this one band came on that was the worst high school band I ever saw in my whole life. And, I mean, they were kind of marching around out of step. Their hats were pointing every which way. Their pants were all baggy. Sometimes there would only be two or three people playing. And so I'm just, like, putting tick marks down like crazy. And pretty soon, about a minute in the show, I had all 200 tick marks used up. And so I continued to run around pretending like I'm still judging, but I wasn't, you know. And they got this long, wavy line that I think might have been a concert formation. And they're standing there playing something. Their feet are all different, the horn angles are all different, and it sounded like a Hoover vacuum cleaner, weirdly. And I'll never forget, so I'm standing on the end of the line, and there's a little girl on the end playing clarinet, perfect posture, neat pressed uniform, hat on straight, and, you know, just doing beautiful. And I'm standing right by her looking down the line like I'm judging, and pretty soon she goes, "Isn't this awful?" You know what? That's the only thing I remember about that day. I wanted to give all the points back for general fit, because that's the best thing I've heard about general fit. But my other favorite story, and I have to say a bad word, but it's worth it. This word's a dictionary, so. But anyway, I'm judging in Amarillo, Texas. They have that, whatever they call it, the Greater Southwest Band Festival, whatever it is. And, you know, they're kind of cheap, because what they do is when they're changing the stage for the bands, you run across the street and you judge a small ensemble. You know, if you want to eat, you got to, like, eat a sandwich on the way. I mean, I'm not liking this gig. And I'm running back and forth, and I'm in a bad mood. So I go running across to judge an ensemble, and as I walk in, these four trumpet players come out. They were obviously Hispanic because of the way they had played. All dressed alike, they came in like, they brought their horns up together, and they ripped this piece off fast and loud and staccato. You sound like four Rafael Mendezes, you know. And it lasted like 30 seconds. Before I even got the music out of the score, out of the envelope, they were done. You know, finally I found the music and I'm looking at it. I said, "Gentlemen, your responsibility as an ensemble is to convey the thoughts of the composer. Your music is clearly marked adagio, which is very slow. Pianissimo, which is very soft. And legato means smooth and sustained." And they're sitting there. Pretty soon the third kid, he goes to the fourth kid, he goes, "You done shit." You know what? That made the whole trip worthwhile. Changed my whole attitude. And so we're so lucky to be in a profession which has so many great experiences. And you know, I think the older you get, the more opinionated you get. And you gain, you know, and you grow, and you try to improve yourself. And so I wanted to start off by showing you something that I used to do with the marching Illini that sort of conveys why you're probably here today. Usually the first rehearsal, I draw this scale, it's called a continuum, which is Latin for continuous, often to infinity, never reaches the upright position. You know, it just gets gradually and gradually more and more upright. So down here we have bad bands. Here we have average bands. Here we have good bands. And here we have great bands. You can also apply that to you as a band director or as a teacher, as far as what your achievements are. As you can see, going from bad to average doesn't take a lot of effort. It's like riding a bicycle up a hill. And so we can achieve that with not a whole lot of effort. But then all of a sudden, if we want to get better than average and become good at something, progress is much harder. The sacrifice, the time, you have to pedal the bike harder, the hill gets steeper and steeper. And then finally, to become great, which very few people do, involves quite a bit more progress and a lot harder work and sacrifice and effort. And so you work a lot harder to achieve smaller amounts of progress. So that's why our society is mired in mediocrity. Nothing wrong with being average, if that's your goal. And so that's why, you know, we can't say the majority of people are bad, or the majority of people are good, and almost no one's great, because of the effort. And so that's why I put across the top of your sheet a quote that I heard Bill Belichick, Patriots coach, on TV being interviewed a couple years ago. And when he said this, my head almost exploded. He said, you know, a goal without a plan is a wish. It doesn't get any simpler than that. I don't think there's anyone in here that doesn't want to have a great plan. It's a wish. And of course, the plan, there are so many ways. But the plan, the effectiveness of your plan, is really contingent on just how much you'll achieve your goals. And I've never heard known a band that wanted to be. And Bobby Knight, you say the same thing. He says, you know, every basketball team wants to win all the games. But very few are willing to work hard enough to become good enough to win all the games, which he did 5 times in the national championship. And so all my life, ever since I was a high school kid, I've been fascinated by leaders, which is how I want to open up the thing today. Because it sets the tone of who we all are, and doesn't matter what you teach or what your age is. And I never attended any leadership workshops, I never read any leadership books, but I did observe what I consider to be great leaders and was fascinated by all of that. And it started when I was in high school. I grew up in Orlando, Edgewater High School. And our basketball team won a state championship. And our tallest guy was like 5'11". And we played, and we beat this NBA team from Miami. That were like, they're all 10 feet tall. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, how does this happen? And then I remember Bill Tressel beating University of Miami his first year at Ohio State, playing a almost professional level football team in Miami. It was supposed to slaughter Ohio State. And here he is with, you know, okay players. And he wins a national championship. And so I'm beginning to think about, what's going on here? Why do these guys, what do they have in common with each other? And it's not what we think. It's not, we have to dispel the myths. Now, all this is in chapter 1 in the book here. And so the printouts I sent him, there were so many that he said, decide what he's going to do is email those to you if you want the PDFs of most of the things we're going to do today. But here's what I found out. It was this simple. Before I tell you how simple it is, how many of you have ever known, like, great musicians who had weak ensembles? Raise your hands. You know, somebody was a great musician, but their ensembles weren't so good. How many of you ever known someone who was just an average musician, but had great ensembles? Raise your hands. So you see what I'm saying? Having the knowledge and skills is not the only answer. What's missing is the ability to transfer it. That's what happens. All of these people I mentioned had phenomenal knowledge, phenomenal skills in their profession. But what they had, which separated them from everyone else, is the ability to transfer it to others. So a lot of, that's why we tell you in college, the most important thing you can do is become proficient on your instrument. Become the best possible musician you can. And also the skills, conducting and so forth. You want to improve those things, but then when you graduate, of course, what we don't teach you to do is how to transfer it to students, because there's so many ways. And we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about leadership concepts. And so it's that simple. having the knowledge and skills and your expertise, and then the ability to transfer it. So what I want to start off with is defining the very basic things about leadership, in my opinion, and what I've experienced. So how do I do this? It's, you got to go to chapter one. You have a document thing?
Yeah.
Okay, well, Where's my book?
Right here.
Okay. All right. So here we go. We're going to start with concepts of leadership, and we're going to keep it simple. My definition of a leader is simply someone who has the ability to change the way people think and or act. That's simple. That covers everything. It covers politics, lawyers, medicine, you know, religion, teaching, athletics. And so then we think about, so basically anyone who has the ability, and everyone does it a different way. You know, and I know you've observed leaders in your times that were radically different from each other and did it in different ways. And so if that's the case, we can dispel all the myths. The myths include things like having a great budget, having great facilities. I can name people who broke those myths. Ron Carter, East St. Louis, inner city school, had best high school jazz band ever. They sound like Count Basie. Kids went from high school jazz ensemble professional play. He had no budget. He had no booster organization. He had no auditorium. He had no assistants. He didn't have a staff. It was Ron Carter, period. He developed this great, and then 50 miles down the road, and I won't name the school, two auditoriums, four band directors, private teachers, you know, huge budget, lots of money, private lessons, not even close to the Ron Carter's jazz ensemble. He's at Northern Illinois now. And so we dispel all those things. We like to make excuses why we don't succeed as leaders, and that we think about all those things, and that's the fact that, okay, I got to have a lot of money, I got to have nice facilities, I got to have, you know, band boosters serve me. And so, therefore, so then I will tell you about Alfred Watkins. If I heard that name, Alfred Watkins at Lasseter High School in Atlanta, Georgia. Perhaps one of the best high school band programs ever, five concert bands, I think it's four now, five concert bands, he just retired, national championship concert, national championship marching, and the most amazing band program ever. And he started his profession in inner city school with nothing and built a great band program. Went to Lasseter, started a program from nothing, and built one of the greatest high school band programs ever. And of course, now he has all those resources because the credibility he gained as a teacher, and the more successful he became, the more resources started pouring in as far as, you know, teaching assistants and all that sort of thing. So now we talk about, next we talk about motivation. Okay. Let's see, let me just scroll down a little bit. Never mind. So we know, okay, so we agree on that as a definition of leadership, okay? Now, the next thing we talk about is motivation. Now, that's another myth. I think we create the idea that our job is to motivate students, to motivate them. In essence, they have to motivate themselves. That's the mistake we make. And they motivate themselves as a result of the experience you're providing them. So I can't motivate you to do anything, but maybe there's something I can do that'll cause you to get excited about what you're doing, and you motivate yourself. And so that's the thing. So what we need to focus on is the experience we're giving the kids. And the number one thing that motivates students is, somebody want to guess? Bigger than that.
Joy.
What?
Joy.
Yeah, that's part of it.
Huh?
What? Part of it?
Success.
Success. Success gets all the byproducts we're looking for. So, we operated, and this is an axiom that I use. I already lost my marker. What's up there? Where?
On the table.
Just, you're going to have to help me get through this, okay? So we operate under a very simple axiom, and I know this is not getting down to why you're here as far as techniques and so forth, and we'll get into that. I'm so happy we have this amount of time so that I don't have to construct my ideas to one copy. But so, what we operate from, and this works and simplifies, the engineers always say, no, it's supposed to be 2S. But anyway, system. System is the plan, like Belichick talked about. It's basically the totality of everything you do as a teacher. Your rules, your regulations, the kind of music you play, the kind of marching band you have, your concepts of sound and so forth. It's the totality of everything you are. Spirit is the totality of everything of the students, how they react to it. So obviously, if the system is effective, they're going to react to it in a positive manner. When they react to it, they'll experience success. And success is what you're looking for, because that's where you develop pride, loyalty, attitudes, discipline. You don't develop discipline in man, you develop success, and the discipline's a byproduct. So that has always been my whole guiding principle of everything that I've ever done, and it works simply because this is the hardest part. When this breaks down, there's something wrong here. If there's something wrong either place, we experience failure. Failure breeds failure. Success breeds success. It's momentum. And when you say, when you want a better budget, when you want to be able to have money to buy oboes and bassoons for your contraband and so forth, then you focus on success. And that's why I find a marching band is the best weapon to use to develop credibility and support in your band program. If you have a great marching band, eventually you're going to be able to generate support for everything you do. And that's when you're able to buy bassoons and oboes and contrabass clarinet. So I always viewed marching band as the weapon to achieve the priorities in a great band program. And that makes the administrators happy, makes the parents happy. So if you have a bad attitude about marching band, it's going to be hard for you. It can be done, and I've seen it, and there's an exception to everything, but. So what we're going to talk about today relates to the system, a way of doing things. Now, the book I got is, I say 50%, maybe 60% of it applies to concert and marching, and or a concert. And to both concert and marching, and about 50% is just marching. So I'm using a lot of this material because it involves an accumulation of ideas over the last 2 years. I started the book in 1983. Most of it is the result of things that I've learned from other people. And when I was young, there weren't a lot of resources. We didn't have computers. We didn't have YouTube. We didn't have electronic devices. We didn't have any of those things, you know? And you couldn't play current arrangements because the publishing companies didn't have it, so you had to learn how to arrange. Of course, back then, you'd get in trouble with copyright. You did pretty much anything you wanted. A lot of things were easier then. You know, you had to worry about every little thing you said. And so now you have the resources. I mean, there's the method books and the what's available on the computer. Oh, my God, it's just all around you. So, in essence, what we're talking about is improving yourself. In other words, in order to achieve results and increase the spirit, the students react in your system, you have to gain, the key word is respect. Respect. Respect is basically how the students perceive you. I remember riding in the car with Andrews, and I said, hey, what do the kids think about Dustin? I said, oh my God, they just think he's the greatest thing ever. They respect him so much. And that gives him the credibility to profess things and to progress along and do accomplish. I mean, you look what this man has done this last 17 years here when he came. And so, as a result, respect also has its myths. It has nothing to do with anything about you, you know, your religion, how you look, what your race is, or how much money you make, none of those things. It has to do with how they react to what you're doing. Let's say, and age has nothing to do it. How old are you?
20.
Okay. Well, I'm 74, and let's say I wanted to learn how to play tennis, and you're a national champion tennis player. And so I want to learn how to play tennis. Now, I'm not going to go to her because she's older because she doesn't know how to play tennis. So I'm going to go to you, and I don't care if you're 20,
you teach me to play tennis, okay? And he said, yeah, sure. Gives me grip, go through all the fundamentals, starts teaching, and I'm experiencing, you know, great joy from this, and pretty soon I'm going to tennis matches, I'm reading books, I'm watching videos, you know, and I'm becoming a good tennis player. And never once did I think, wow, she's only 20, I can't do that. And she's not looking at me and said, well, he's old, I can't teach him to play tennis. So that dispels the age myth, you know. So age has nothing to do with it, whether you're old or young. It has to do with the experience you provide. Now she's impatient with me and gets upset and skips or comes, shows up late to my lessons or cancels or anything. I lose respect for her, and I give up on tennis. And so we draw the analogy, kids quit band. They quit band because they're not enjoying it, they're not benefiting from it, they don't enjoy it. And the first thing we do is blame everybody else except ourselves. And so that comes to another topic that I call self-analysis. The whole idea of self-analysis is to analyze all your strengths and weaknesses. We all have them, don't we? I mean, there isn't anyone in here is perfect. And so the focus is to improve your strengths and capitalize on your, a bit backwards, to capitalize on your strengths and improve your weaknesses. We all have them. I remember the first year that I passed out a student evaluation to my symphonic band in Illinois, thinking that I was going to get all these glowing remarks, you know, and I got home that night and started reading them. I almost wanted to slash my wrist. They ripped me apart. And I'm looking at them going, yeah, I think they're right. And that, I was so discouraged by that because I thought everybody was digging me, you know. And so I started really working. I made a list of all the sayings and what the percentages were. I started working on it right away. The next one I got, the second one, I got the highest review of anyone in the whole music department, of all faculty. The kids noticed it, and all of a sudden, I gained their respect, and all of a sudden, I could accomplish so much more because I was able to overcome the weaknesses. One of my weaknesses was, still, is that I'm a procrastinator and basically a lazy person. And so, I like that better than working hard. And so what happens is, I'm looking out there and I got 380 people in the marching band. Last thing I'm going to do is punish them because, you know, I'm a procrastinator. So I compensated by being overly organized and planning ahead. And if you were to ask any of my kids or Dustin, is he lazy? Is he procrastinating? No, he's well organized and everything's ready to go. Well, I am lazy. I just overcame it. And I compensated by being industrious. So that, and so therefore, some things you won't be able to change about you, but you can compensate for them. A really hard one is getting balance between your family and your job. Well, that's a tough one. Is it possible to be fair to both? And yes, it is. But it isn't easy. You know, and unfortunately, I didn't figure that out until my kids were older. Well, now I'm real close to them, but I didn't go to Little League baseball games and things like you're supposed to do. And I regret that. Now I look back. And if I was young and started over again, I would change the balance in my life. But now I've compensated and I'm close to them and I do everything with them that made up for, redeemed myself. But your family is more important than your job. But it is possible, trust me, it's possible to be effective doing both. Now, I'm skipping around. And today, once we get off the leadership thing, we're going to skip around a bunch and change topics. And then I'm going to want you to interrupt, ask questions, change the things we're going to do, and I'm going to let you choose the topics we go into. But I think the leadership thing is important before we start doing anything as far as techniques and methods, because now this is just all talk, just philosophies. So now we got motivation. We talked about motivation. Now, the style of motivation, two basic approaches, extrinsic and intrinsic. Extrinsic are things like grades, awards, demerit systems. And all those things do contribute to our motivation. Intrinsic is what people do because they want to. Okay, you show up on time for rehearsal tonight, or we're going to lower your grade to letter. Or everybody shows up on time, you didn't even say. That's what you ultimately want. And it's the hardest thing to do, so we depend on extrinsic motivation. Nothing wrong with it, because that works too.
But if you want people who have lifetime experience in your ensembles, in which they'll reflect when they get into their older lives, then intrinsic is what develops loyalty toward your ensembles and making the sacrifices you want. Now, so I'm going to tell you a story about two scenarios. My first year at Illinois, I was asked to come and work with two high school bands that were in small country farm towns, about 60 kids in each band. So the first night I go, and it was a night rehearsal, so they had to show up outside of school. The first rehearsal I go to, there's only about 45 showed up, about 15 people missing. And he's like, "Oh, I'm really sorry, this is a farm town, and the kids have duties at home, and some of them just couldn't get away, parents wouldn't let them, and we'll do it." And then about a week later, I went to another farm town band about 60 miles down the road. Every kid was there. Same environment, same situation, and they were all there. And I got to thinking about that, you know, and I'm realizing that this director had developed tremendous intrinsic motivation. We're having a guest conductor in next Thursday night, like to have everybody there, everybody shows up. That's pretty rare. But I'll tell you what, I see examples of it right here. Look at all the college students. They don't have to be here today. It's not part of their grade. They're not going to get punished if they don't come. So why did they come? We have two high school students here. There's no requirement, you know, to be here. And so, you know, and here I'm preaching to the choir because you're here. And here's a resource that you've taken advantage of. And you don't have to be here. So that tells me that you are the kind of people who are into improving yourself. Because the better you make yourself, the more you have to offer your kids. The better you make yourself, the more you have to offer the kids. And it never ends. Norville's practicing his trumpet at 86 years old. And boy, have you seen all the stuff on TED and all the stuff that's on the internet about playing an instrument? It's like now they found out that if you play a music instrument when you're a young kid, it raises your IQ. We used to just say that, you know, because we wanted kids to be in our band when I taught high school. You know, and the PE teachers didn't like that. They go, no, you just attract smart kids. No, I think it really makes them smarter if they play an instrument. Now I can show them in black and white. Just go on and type it in, and TED and all. There's just tons of documented medical research now that proves that kids play musical instrument raise their IQ. And if you play musical instrument when you're older, it's 70% less chance of Alzheimer. And look at Norval, 86. He's sharp, and he practices trumpet every day. And I've got a community band. And I told him that, you know, there's a lot of old people in there. And I said, you know, you keep playing that instrument, you got 70% less chance of Alzheimer. It must be working because you're all here tonight. So your growth as a musician is you self-motivate yourself is basically because you want to improve yourself because you have more to offer others. Now, in leadership on here we talk about purpose. There's a difference in purpose. How many of you people have known directors whose purpose was to build a name for themselves, win trophies, and become well known? And how many of you ever known people that had wonderful bands, but they weren't well known, and their purpose wasn't to win contests? You see, and the person we're honoring tonight, Bob Jorgensen, was a good example of that. His students were all successful, and that's what he was number one. And this is why Dustin has this philosophy. Because he cares more about the students than building a name. He had an opportunity. He's been here 17 years. He had opportunities to move on. But he stayed here and he built a program. Because his interest was more about the students. And they know that. That's why they respect him. And Bob Jorgensen was at Akron how many years? 25 years. He also could have moved on. He didn't. So the purpose is, now look at the difference. There are people who are effective leaders, but they also do evil things. You look at Hitler. He was if you apply the leadership definition to him,
he actually changed the way people think and the way they behave. But his case, it was to gain self-power, self-recognition, and to control, eventually rule the world. Then you look at the other opposite and extreme, you got someone like Martin Luther King, who also had that same impact as a leader, but his purpose was to improve our society, not to make a big name for himself, and to make, you know, to develop equality, develop, you know, harmony amongst the nation. Here's men whose purpose was the opposite from each other. So that's the next thing you have to look at. Why am I doing this? Do you know who the most valuable music teachers are? Elementary, then middle school, then high school, then college. What do? We somehow, we think, oh, college is it, man. That's the place. It's not. And I found out, you know, from experience, I had two sons, and one of them had a great elementary teacher and learned and was motivated. And then two or three years later, had a bad teacher, but survived it because the first experience was with a great teacher, survived the bad teacher and didn't affect me. Where the other one started out with a really bad teacher and then had a good one later on, but the damage was already done. Well, how many of us know about that in feeding our music programs? You want to have a great high school band, you need great middle school and elementary. That's where it's at. And we all sweat that, you know, hoping that we've got good middle school people. And so I look at it this way. Most important people in our college bands are the elementary teachers, then the junior high, then high school, because that progression of maturation, that's the progress. And the best players we get had those great experiences when they were young. Most of them. Some of them developed at a later age. So that's why we have to quit putting the prestige level based upon whether you teach college or high school. We put the emphasis on being great teachers, period. No matter where you are and what you teach. And you take what you have, you take the resource you have, and you build a program. And you don't expect it to be handed to you in a silver platter. Don't expect it to, you know, get all the support you want. And you get support by earning it. And the respect was the key. Okay, so I want to make sure I covered everything in this chapter first. And then we're gonna get into the real. Positive versus negative reinforcement. I've seen them both work. Look at Bobby Knight. Throwing chairs, yelling, screaming, cussing and everything, and he won 5 national championships. That's how Bill Trussell, he goes to church, he goes to band concerts. He went to the band concerts at Youngstown State. Steve Gage, the director, he came to all the band concerts. Never swore, calm, easy, and he won national championship. So, but if you're going to be in someone's group, what would you rather have, you know? If you're a participant in a group, wouldn't you rather have someone's positive? Now, it's hard to be positive, but you still got to be honest. You can't say, wow, you sound great, and they don't. That's not what I'm talking about. It's more like, well, we could be better if you do this. Okay, that was better, but it's still not there, you know, as opposed, that's bad. You're bad. You sound bad. You're bad. So that's another consideration in leadership styles. They both work. I learned that the hard way. When I started teaching high school in Indiana, all the good high school bands, they were run like Nazi Germany. It was so, the directors were brutal. They would do things like stand, if they made a mistake, stand at attention 10 minutes while I have a cup of coffee. They would kick kids. They would call them names. I mean, this, it was brutal. The teaching style, with marching bands especially, it was really brutal. And in that, when I inherited the state champion band program in Indiana, my first year teaching. And so when I came in, I'm more laid back, you know, easy going. And they're like, come on, you gotta be mean, you know, you gotta be mean to us, since we're not gonna be any good, you're not mean enough. And I was like, well, okay, I guess that's what I gotta do. So I started being mean, and they were with it. Then I met Joe Smith, who became a mentor of mine, Middle Tennessee State. He's the guy that invented breaking down steps into small parts. Long before drum course. And we give them all too much credit. And so I went and to take lessons from him on breaking down step. And I brought this subject up. And he was so calm and easy going.
I said, do you yell and scream in your band? He said, no, why? I said, well, in Indiana, that's what we do. Why? Well, because that's what we do. Well, he says, you know, that's not important. What's important is how well you teach and how well your methods are and so forth. And just be yourself, you know? And okay, so I went back and we reverted back to being more positive and all that. Kids are going, what's wrong? What's wrong? I mean, they did, at first they're like, this is not good because we're not going to be good unless you're mean to us. And so finally, little by little, they begin to figure out we can still accomplish the same things without all this yelling, screaming, calling names and all that. And I could be myself. Boy, then it became more teaching, more enjoyable to teach because I didn't have to role play something that wasn't natural for me. And so this whole idea of negative reinforcement, it works. And if it's in your nature, go ahead with it. But I wouldn't want to be in your band. And when I was in my college band at Butler, my section leader used to yell at us all the time. Pick your feet up, this, your horn angle, and all that. And it's like, and I kept, you know, every time that happened, I kept thinking, when I'm a band director, I'm not going to do that. So a lot of times we learn from bad experiences, like, no, we can't do this. And so that's how important the negative is important. Problem solving. Okay. Well, first of all, self-improvement. I kind of touched on self-improvement. In other words, it's constant. So when you improve this, then what improve? You got to work on upgrading yourself. The number one thing is your musicianship, because that's the glass ceiling with your group. You want your group to get more musical, you've got to improve your own musicianship. So you understand how to shape lines, how to play with expression, how to taper release phrases, you know, how to count rhythms, how to teach articulations. So you have to, the more of a better musician you are, the higher the ceiling for your accomplishment. This is a salivation. I made this chart up that I give to my section leaders. And it's basically what you do is you rate yourself with a dot from 0 to 100. You want to show? Oh, there it is. So what you do, these are characteristics I made up of what I think good leaders. You put a dot on everything, you know, where you think you are, being honest. You might even have someone else do it. Then you connect the dots and you get a graph. And you can see on this graph exactly where your strengths and weaknesses are. And then you work on it. Maybe a month later you go do it again with a different color pencil. Or if you really want to get a shock, let someone else do it, anonymously do one on you. You know, if you really want to get the truth. And so this is what I used to use with my section leaders before we started our section leader camp. I said, okay, so... And at our drum major camp, now we do this. And so this week, you're going to really focus on your weaknesses. And so that self-evaluation is part of the leadership. Then the book gets into, and I won't want to get into in detail, student leadership. The biggest consideration of student leadership is this. Don't ever give them responsibilities that involve making decisions on policies or discipline. That's your job. Only give them responsibilities that will make your job easier. Logistics and things like, you know, taking attendance, putting the sound systems out, and all those kind of things, library work. They can do all those kind of things. And again, it's in there, a list of all the things they can do. But then you got to train them. You can't just give them a title, say, you're the trombone section leader, okay? You're in charge of rehearsing the music and so forth, and expect they're going to be consistent with what you want as far as how to teach and run sectionals and all that. So you got to train them. And I used to do that in the spring, not during marching season. We'd interview and all that, and then we had workshops, one for music, one for marching. Now, you may want to just have a woodwind and a brass and a percussion person. You may want to have, we used to have a section leader for first, second, third trumpet, first, third, so trumpet. Half the band had a leadership role. And then we had squad leaders, and then they would not be the section leaders, so you got them as leaders. Then you had assistant squad leaders that would take over when a squad leader was missing and would move up. And pretty soon, almost everybody in the band had leadership responsibility. And they liked the titles. But then the titles mean nothing. And I told the
the college students yesterday. How many of you ever known someone who had a title, but they weren't very good leaders? Anybody know anybody like that? How many of you ever known somebody that were really great leaders, but didn't have any kind of title? So the titles don't mean anything, do they? And you know, and that's with your band. You say, okay, just because you're the trumpet section leader doesn't mean you're going to be effective or be respected by the students. It doesn't necessarily mean you are a good leader just because you have a title. So the first thing you got to do is select people who have potential to be good leaders. And there's many ways to do that. And then you got to train them. Exactly. Here are your duties. And don't go beyond that. And Dustin's got a story about that. And so I used to tell the section leaders, you can do this, you can do this, and you can do this, but you can't do this, this, and this. So one day, I had a girl show up in marching band without her horn, which means you're an alternate, you don't march. And so the section leader, the phone says, you're an alternate, you're not going to march because you're going to bring a horn. Well, she comes up afterwards crying, you know, to me. And I said, what happened? She said, well, so-and-so made me because I didn't bring my horn. And the rule is, if you don't bring your horn to rehearsal, then you're an alternate. But what happened was, on the way to rehearsal, someone rear-ended her car, and the instrument was in the trunk, and smashed the trunk so they couldn't get the trunk open. Now, she tells the policeman and this person, I can't be late for rehearsal or I'll be an alternate. So here's the information, and then ran to rehearsal, left the car on the side of the road, and of course couldn't get her horn, you know, and she makes rehearsal on time, and we're going to make her an alternate? Because that should have been my decision to make that, because of extenuating circumstances, I would have not made her. I'd give her a medal and use her as an example of dedication. And so here is an example of student leaders overstepping their authority. So you have to make sure with the student leaders that they do not overstep authority that you have given them, and you have to be specific. In addition to running music rehearsals, you've got to tell them how to run the music rehearsals. If they can't sing all the rhythms in a piece of music, how are they going to run a sectional? You know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Okay, let's play that. They can't play it. Oh, it's not right. Keep playing. It's not right. Oh, okay, no. It's like this. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. No. Say that with me. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Say it, and I'll play it. I mean, so they have to be musically prepared to be able to handle music rehearsals. Same thing with marching rehearsals. They have to know how to correct the bad glide step, how to correct timing problems, how to correct horn angles, all those kind of things. So they have specific things. You know, as an example, in marching band camp, when we teach fundamentals, and I teach them the glide step, and I break it down and all that, and we work as a big group in circles. Then I say, section leaders, go clean it. So what I don't want you to do is take your group and do the same thing I just did. I want you to take a look at them one at a time and correct individual differences. Don't just run it as a group. We can do that here. So when they come back, I want to see all those mistakes corrected. So you got to learn how to scan. You got to scan the feet. You got to scan the horn angles. And you got to train them exactly what to do. And so your student leaders. So student leadership is a very important part. Keep them engaged. So... And there's so much they can do if you train them. So the whole idea is to make your job easier on you by delegation of authority. So tell them your story about you guys, the TA, selecting alternates.
Why?
Because it's an example of what we were just talking about. And so anyway, as long as the responsibilities are clearly defined and everybody understands what they are, no, you don't have to.
I'll do it. So all of the TAs, Gary has a meeting with all the teaching assistants.
I'm only doing this because I got to get them.
For the marching Illini, and there are like eight of us. And the worst responsibility that we had, in addition to all of the great responsibilities, was we had to select the alternates for home football games. And that was based on, marching ability, how well they played their music, etc. So the band had 350, but only 266 marched in the block. The high school directors loved this because you never marched a hole, right? You just plugged someone else in. There's never a hole on the field. So we have our first meeting before we're set to select alternates, and Gary looks at all of us in the eye, one by one, and says, whatever you do, don't tell a kid you're making them an alternate because they have a bad attitude. But, you know, I was 25, I knew everything, right? So we go out, and we're observing, and we select alternates. And the first person that I ever selected to be an alternate with the Marching Illini asked me why, and I said, because you have a bad attitude. Just like that. So this girl's very upset, clarinet player. I was on the clarinet detail that week, very upset. And she goes to Gary after rehearsal. That was another amazing thing. The kids handled their differences between each other. If it got to Gary, crap was going to hit the fan. So I thought, wow, this has been great. I've been a TA here for 2 weeks. He's going to take away my assistantship and everything. So he calls me into the office, and he, the assistant, Pete Griffin at the time, we met up in his office, and it was like a scene from Goodfellas. So and these two guys are going to rough me up, and I'm standing there, you know, shaking and whatnot. And he asked me, so why did you pull this girl from the show this week? I said, that's when it dawned on me. Just before, he told us not to pull these people based on having a bad attitude. So, guess who the person that I selected as an alternate and told she had a bad attitude went on to be? Chief librarian for the United States Marine Band. Her name's Megan Benson. And what I didn't know when I told her that she had a bad attitude was she was the top clarinet player in the state of Illinois the year before as a high school senior. Now, she might have been having a bad day, for all I know, but she didn't have a bad attitude, I know that. So you can never judge a book by its cover. Yeah. And it's probably just facial expressions and how she was responding to things that I had no idea what they were. So thanks.
There's a reason I want you to hear that. No, but there's a lesson to be learned from that. Because the last thing I want to do in leadership is talk about, I forgot about that's a topic in the leadership thing, and that's the process of becoming the judge, jury, and executioner. We call it problem solving. And so problem solving is probably the biggest issue you deal with in teaching, because you have so many of them. But for example, when I used to teach my marching band class, I would draw a circle like that, and I'd say, what is that? And, you know, first thing pops your mind is a circle. And then I say, well, what else could that be? And then you switch into what I call the creative mode. Okay, it could be an object. It could be a straight line that's been bent around. It could be four arcs joined together. It could be the top of a rod. I mean, it could be so many things. But if you look at that and you see all you see is a circle, they're going to limit your solution to writing throw. If you see two, four arcs, you get different ideas and so forth. I'll show you this one then. That's an aerial view of a Mexican fat man. That's a soldier going around the corner with his dog. Sorry, I didn't mean this. Remember Doodles? When Doodles was always on Doodles?
Yeah.
Okay. But anyway, so the whole process, now I don't know if you've been reading about all this stuff about creativity comes to the left hemisphere of the brain and all that. They're beginning to find out that it's all baloney. They're beginning to find out creativity comes is all different types, different places in your brain. Watch TED. And then we'll be sure you Google playing musical instrument and brains. And watch the TED presentations on that. And then in addition to that, you can look up the medical. It shows you what happens in the brain and all that. It really does raise your IQ. And so we have to use that creative power to solve problems, and discipline's one of them. Because you know and I know, if some kid smarts off in band, she's telling me all the different things you think might have caused that to happen. Go ahead, you got one? You just scratch it? Okay. So what are all the different reasons you think of why this kid might have smarted off to you, other than having an attitude problem?
They're embarrassed.
What?
They're embarrassed. They can be embarrassed.
Embarrassed? Reaction? What else?
Problems at home.
Problems at home? What else?
Hungry.
Hungry, yeah. Yeah, I guess that applies to me. We're hungry all the time. And they're sheep bourbon.
It just wasn't their day.
They're bored and they need attention.
That's right, bored and need attention. They don't like you. But you know what? It's just, the point I'm making is this. The little process your brain just went through to start thinking, that's like what I call creative thinking. And so when you look at a problem, you may have to come up with as many reasons for existence that problems you possibly can to find a solution. And what happens is the younger people are, the quicker they pass judgment, the less creative thinking they are. And the first thing that pops in their mind is that's a circle, and the kids, it has a bad attitude. And seldom is that the reason. There's quite a lengthy thing in the book about this. And here's where I learned that lesson. I was at Indiana State years before I went to University of Illinois. And I always used to pride the fact that the band that traveled so well. The manners, you know, following the rules, dressing nice, behaving in restaurants, behaving in hotels. And I always was really concerned about not being the typical kind of band that does a lot of damage when we travel, but have a real professional attitude about it. And I was very strict about that. So we're at Indiana State, or Illinois State, staying overnight. And about 2 o'clock in the morning, one of the graduate assistants knocks on my door and says, Bill, and I can't remember his last name, the tuba player, just put his fist through the wall in the room. And I'm thinking, oh, he's probably drunk. And, you know, and I just exploded. I ran in his room and said, Bill, you're out of band. You go apologize to the hotel manager, and you pay for the damages, and I don't want to see you back in band ever again. Well, so then Monday rehearsal comes, and I felt this unbelievable curtain between me and the band. I was like, what is going on, you know? Really spooky, and they're just like, you know, like this around me, you know, and so forth. And one of the students in the band was like a son to me, from way back when he was in high school. He came in my office, you know, and I called him in the office, what's going on with the band? He says, you don't know? I go, no, what? He says, the way you handled the Bill situation. I said, we have our rules, you know, you can't let kids get away with things like that. He said, well, did you bother to find out what happened? I go, no, it doesn't really matter, does it? He said, well, yeah, it does, because what happened was his father had been killed in an auto accident 3 days before, and this was a delayed reaction. If you ever lost someone close to that, which I experienced later, sometimes when someone really close to you dies, you don't really believe it until later, and then it hits you. And that's what, all of a sudden, 2 o'clock in the morning, my dad is dead, and he put his fist through the wall, and I'm thinking, oh my God, the damage I have done. I just like felt so bad, and I didn't know, what am I going to do? And so I called Bill. He was the best. I should have known, because he was the best tuba player I had and was the best student in the band, you know, and somehow I disregarded all that. And I called him in. I said, I found out about your dad. And I am so embarrassed and upset with myself and the way I handled that. And I want to somehow find a way to redeem myself, because I realize now that what I did was pretty much the opposite of what I should have done. And I just want you to know this. I will never make the same mistake in my life again. I will never pass judgment on someone's behavior without knowing all the facts in my teaching. So that's the one redeeming fact. I said, what can I do to make this right? He said, you just did. That's it? Yeah. You learned something from this? I said, I want you back in the band like it was before, and you're willing to forgive me for that? And he said, of course. He was back in the band. All of a sudden, the curtain came back up. And that caused me to write that chapter in my book about passing judgment on negative behavior, because it's seldom what it appears to be on the surface. And the last thing you want kids want, they don't want their integrity questioned. And you can't pass judgment that quick.
And so you have to be creative, and again, in solving problems with situations, with all kinds of problems, lack of budget, lack of facilities, all these things, there's always a solution to every problem, but the creative people are the ones who find the answers. And so that stuck in my brain, and it was the most valuable lesson I learned about passing judgment and executing, observing, passing a judgment, and then executing. So don't you make those mistakes. You're young, and you can capitalize on things we learned here today. So that sums up the leadership aspect of what we're going to do today. So do you have anything you want to discuss, questions you want to answer and ask related to this topic, because we're going to move on to other things now, methods and techniques. Anything you want to say or questions you want to ask or anything about this? Yeah.
How could you possibly try to work with somebody who's frustrating you personally and try to work past those differences so that way you can get things done?
Okay, so I'm glad you did. She's asked a specific, say it a little louder so they all hear you.
How are you going to be able to work through a frustrating situation with a person who is making it really difficult for you to work with them?
Okay, and so a lot of people go to clinics and what they want are formulas and answers that they can apply in all situations. What we really want to do is develop the process of problem solving rather than saying, okay, when this happens, do this. When this happens, do that. Instead, when this happens, here's the process to go through to find the answer, solution to the problem. There's no way I could answer any of those kind of questions you're going to ask me unless I'm experiencing it myself and I'm there to observe and understand thoroughly. But what I can offer you, and that's this, and that's to find, you know, to analyze the situation and delve into it and get more background about what's going on so you can find the most appropriate situation. And so therefore, you saw an example where I did the worst possible solution to a problem instead of the best possible solution to the problem. And so in this case, you know, I would begin to answer a question like that simply because there's too much information that you need to have. But what I will tell you is there's a way. And we've all been confronted with those kind of things, and we find a way. But somehow, you have to find a solution that will cause them to respect you. You can't demand it. You can't ask for it. There has to be behavior on your part that will cause them to change on their own. Because remember, you can't change the way people think, but you can create an environment that causes them to change the way they think. You see what I'm saying? So it's the process you want to learn, the process of problem solving, rather than taking each situation and going to somebody, so-and-so did this, what should I do? Okay. And you know, your brain is really a living organism. You know, you can exercise your brain. It's like, if I say, go home and start doing push-ups tonight, and then you do one tonight, and then a couple weeks later, you do two or three, and 4 or 5 months later, you're doing better. Well, it's the same thing with the process of creative thinking. When you first start doing it, you are exercising parts of your brain that you may not have exercised, and you'll get better at it. That's why you know people that are like really creative, because they practice being creative. They actually utilize that kind of thinking more than you do, but you have the same potential to be just as creative by exercising that part of your brain. You know, through reading, doing clinics like this, going to workshops, observing successful people. And not that you, Bijan always told me, Dr. Bijan is God to me, told me, you don't want to be like somebody else that you respect, but you want to be affected by somebody else. So don't try to look like me or talk like me or do the things I do, but try to be affected by those things to improve yourself. So you want to ever try to be like somebody else, but they should influence you. And you know, have you ever thought about, one of the things I like to do in a class like this when we have time today is to take a sheet of paper, draw a line down the middle, and on one side, pick out one of the people you admire more than anybody in the world and list all the things about them you admire. Then on the other thing, put down someone you don't admire the most and then list all the things, you know, the qualities that cause you not to admire them. And then you look at that list and you say, am I guilty of any of these bad things? Am I capable of all these good things? You know, someone that's like real positive, I could be positive. Someone that's very organized, I could be organized. You know, someone that's reads a lot of Ted's clinics. I can read a lot of Ted's clinics. So you're going to find that the people that you admire are not doing anything you can't do. And you can tell your band that. You know, I was working with this one high school band in Vegas last week. I won $2,600 playing blackjack. I mean, not that that's the most important thing. But it's up there. Was that during the
rehearsal?
No. It's the jet lag, you know, waking up 3 in the morning, nothing to do. So I took a little bit of money. I went across the street to the casino. I sat down at the cheap table, and I couldn't lose. I win $300. So the next morning, I get up again. I take that money. I go to a more expensive table. Could not lose. I take that money the third day, and I go to the high stake table, $25 table, $25 bet. I had $600 profit. If I lose the $600, I'll quit, and that's it. I couldn't lose again. I kept getting more. The green chips are $25. So every time I would get $100, I would put it over here, and I started stacking it. And I stacked them what I thought was $300 per stack. And I said, as soon as I hit 5 stacks, I'm going to quit. I hit 5 stacks. I pushed it in, expecting to get $1,500. And he says, that's $2,000. There was $400 in each stack. So I walked out with $2,600. Then my wife found out about it. I can't find it now. I don't know where it is. All I know is I hope she doesn't spend to buy more pillows for her damn bed. I said, why do we have to make pillows? Are people going to walk in and go, wow, they must be really making it. Oh, and how we have on our couch, there's nowhere to sit. Pillows off, got people coming over. She says, after they see the pillows. Everybody walks, I go, okay, everybody see the pillows? Okay, anything else you wanted to ask or talk about related to leadership concepts? Okay, what I wanted to do next, the one advantage of being really old is you see a lot. And I've been teaching 52 years, and boy, I've seen a lot. And so what I'm going to do now, we're going to talk about music applies to concert and in marching in some cases. I'm going to discuss the typical things I see happening in all bands, even the good ones, in typical contests. It's almost like when I do evaluations, I don't judge contests anymore because, you know, I will critique and I'll do clinics, but I won't judge because, especially marching bands, because I don't like what they do now. And